Hello, good evening. Last class, we just started a priori definition of probability. I told you the probability is calculated without conducting the experiment. That is called a priori probability. Now, I told you the probability of the occurrence of an event is given by a formula m by n, where m is number of favorable cases and n stands for number of equally likely cases or equally likely events. Definitely m is less than or equal to n, therefore m by n is less than or equal to 1. P of a is nothing but m by n, therefore P of a is less than or equal to 1. By axiom, I told you P of A is greater than or equal to 0. By axiom, fundamental axiom, probability of occurrence of an event is a non-negative real number. That means P of A is always greater than or equal to 0. Greater than or equal. But just now we have seen by definition, a priori definition of probability, M by N is less than or equal to 1, that is P of A is less than or equal to 1. Therefore, probability occurrence of an event lies between 0 and 1. It lies between 0 and 1. It is, if it is 0, I told you last, if probability of A is 0, A is called impossible event. A is called impossible event. A is called impossible event. If P of A is 0. If P of A is 1, then A is called certain event. Then A is called certain event. Certain event is bound to occur. So, P of A is 1, A is certain event. P of A is 0, A is impossible event. Okay. Now, we have seen about the playing cards. We'll solve some problems under ordinary probability. A pack contains 52 cards. Last class, we have seen a pack contains 52 cards. There are 26 red cards and 26 black cards. 26 black cards. Among 26 red cards, 13 are diamond and the remaining 13 are heart. That is, you get a heart. And here, among these 26 black cards, 13 are spades. 13 are spades. The remaining 13 are clubs. Remaining 13 are clubs. In these 13 diamonds, we are having ace diamond, 2 diamond, 3 diamond, 10 diamond, jack diamond, king diamond. Similarly, even these 13 hearts, you get ace heart, 2 hearts, 10 hearts, jack hearts, queen hearts, king hearts, 2, 3, 4, etc. up to 10. Similarly, 13 spade, you get ace spade, 2 spade, 3 spade, 10 spade, jack spade, queen spade, king spade. Similarly, 13 clubs, S clubs, 2 clubs, 10 clubs, jack clubs, queen clubs. That means in a pack of cards, 52 cards are there. We are having four suits. One is a heart. Next one is diamond. Then spade. Third one is spade. And fourth one is clubs. So these two are red in color, these two are black in color. We are having 13 in each suit. I told you there are four aces. Ace. There are four aces, four twos, four tens. And four jacks, like that, four kings, four queens, four jacks, like that. Now, there are 26 red cards, 26 black cards, and 13 in each suit. There are four suits, 4 into 13, 52. Simple problems can be solved. A card is drawn from a pack of cards. A card is drawn from a pack. What's the probability what is the probability that, what is the probability that it is subdivision 1, what is the probability that it is a king, first subdivision it's a king. Second subdivision, what is the probability it is king red in color, king red in color. Third one, what is the probability it is king spade, what is the probability it is king spade. And what is the probability, fourth one, it is a spade, what's the probability it is a spade. See here, there are 52 cards, therefore m is equal to 52. Out of these 52 cards you can take any one. Out of 52 cards we can take any one. Therefore there are 52 equally likely events or 52 equally likely cases. For the first subdivision, what is the probability of drawing a king? You are taking one card, what is the probability it's a king? How many are favorable to this? There are four kings, I told you, king, king diamond, king heart, king spade and king clubs. There are four kings, so therefore the probability of drawing a king is nothing but 4/52. For the first subdivision, answer is 4/52. 4/52. What's the probability that it is a red king? What's the probability of drawing a king? Subject to the condition, it is red in color. I told you there are two red kings. One is king diamond, other is king heart. So therefore, what is the probability of drawing a king red in color? King red. So there are two kings red in color. So answer is 2/52. 2/52. King spade. A spade, 2 spade, 10 spade, jack spade, queen spade, king spade. So king spade, only one king spade. Therefore, probability of drawing a king spade is nothing but 1/52. 1/52. And what is the probability of drawing a spade in general? What's the probability of drawing a spade? How many spades are there? There are 13 spades. I told you, yes, up to king. So therefore, 13/52 is the answer. 13/52 is the answer. Therefore, the probability of drawing a spade is 13/52. The probability of drawing king spade is 1/52. King red in color is 2/52. And the probability of drawing a king is 4/52. So therefore, using playing cards, we can get any probability. Now, we can also introduce the concept of permutation combination in this. So, in this context, I want to touch permutation combination. But before that, we will solve some problems under ordinary probability. After that, we will go to permutation based probability. Okay, I told you last class, you know, if I have given already, it's a revision. You can take this as a revision. This is very, very important. This is very, very important. This is called a 9-square table. This is called a 9-square table. A is the, suppose A stands for one attribute, that is literacy. We take A as literacy. That is, A stands for A within bracket number of literates. Suppose there are a sample space, there are 1000 persons in a village. There are 1000 persons in a village, out of which 800 are literates. Understand the problem carefully. There are 1000 persons, 800 are literates. And automatically A bar stands for illiterates. A bar stands for illiterates. Illiterates. Then automatically we simply say 200 are illiterates. 200 are illiterates. Okay. We introduce criminality. We introduce the attribute criminality. So B within bracket gives us number of criminals. So we take it as 700. Out of 1000 population, 700 are criminals. Out of 1000 population, 800 are literates. 200 are literates. Out of 1000, 700 are criminals. Then automatically B bar stands for non-criminals. B bar stands for non-criminals. Therefore, we simply say this B bar is nothing but 300. Because 700 plus 300 is 1000. 1000, 700 criminals, 300 non-criminals, total 1000. 800 literates, 200 illiterates, total 1000. Same person. Out of 800 literates, 550 are criminals. Or out of 700 criminals, 550 are literates. Understand carefully, this is very important for competent examination. Many problems can be solved. Out of 800 literates, 550 are criminals. Or out of 700 criminals, 550 are literates. This way or that way. So remaining, we say, this is 150. 150 stands for illiterate criminals, A bar intersection B. Now here, this is 50. This is 250. So this sum is this, 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 and this sum is automatically equal to this. So therefore, from this table, if you take this as A within bracket and A intersection B, I will prepare one more table for understanding so that it gives us a very good idea. A here, B here, A bar here, B bar here, and this is A intersection B. Number of persons having both attributes, literacy and criminality. This is A bar intersection B. The total is B. And similarly, A intersection B bar, A bar intersection B bar, this is B bar. And this is A bar, that is A, this is A bar, this is S. Now see here, from this table, we can form the following relations. This plus this is equal to this. Therefore, we can simply say the probability of A intersection B plus the probability of A intersection B bar is equal to probability of A. That is, if you have A is fixed, only B bar, then automatically this is probability of A. Similarly, A bar intersection B, the probability of A bar intersection B plus the probability of A bar intersection B bar is equal to probability of A bar. Adding these two, you get. Similarly, the probability of A intersection B plus the probability of A bar intersection B is equal to probability of B. And similarly, the probability of A intersection B bar plus the probability of A bar intersection B bar is equal to probability of B bar. And automatically, P of A plus P of A bar is equal to 1. So automatically, P of A plus P of A bar is equal to 1. So probability occurrence of an event, probability occurrence of the non-event, that is complement of that event, is equal to 1. And similarly here, P of B plus P of B bar is definitely equal to 1. That is probability of S. So once you are thorough with these 6 results, many problems can be solved only by completing this 9 square table. Suppose in this example, by completing the table, if this is 50, this 50 stands for number of illiterate non-criminals. Therefore, what is the probability of selecting one candidate who is illiterate non-criminal? The answer is 50 by 1000. Number of favorable cases by number of equal likely cases, 50 by 1000. What is the probability of drawing illiterate criminal? Illiterate criminal 150, illiterate criminal 150 by 1000 gives the probability of getting illiterate criminal. What is the probability of selecting a literate criminal? Literate criminal 550 by 1000. So therefore, we understand from this, many literates are criminals. So therefore, the probability of drawing a literate criminal is 550 by 1000. The probability of drawing literate non-criminal, it is very less, 200 by 1000. Probability of drawing literate, that means 800 by 1000. illiterate 200 by 1000, criminals 700 by 1000, non-criminals 300 by 1000, and so on. So therefore, we can, once you know the attribute, we can get a probability of anything. I will illustrate with another example so that you can have a clear-cut idea about this. Suppose I am giving you one data. It's very important for competent examination. They will give the data like this. You can take the same number. There are 1000 students studying in a college. And A stands for number of students who are taking T. Then automatically A bar stands for the students who are saying no to T. So therefore, A within bracket gives number of persons who are taking T. You take this as 800. And then automatically number of persons who are not taking T is nothing but 200. It is obvious. 800, that is 200. Once this is fixed, that is fixed. Once you say the probability of saying no to T, that is the number of persons saying no to T is 200, automatically 1000, this is 800. Similarly, coffee, number of persons who are taking coffee, this is one attribute. So there are 700 persons, we can also take 750. 750 are taking coffee. 750 are taking coffee. Then automatically 215 are not taking coffee. 250 are not taking coffee. Therefore, once you know this number as 100, 100 persons are not taking or saying no to coffee, and 100 persons are saying no to tea. That is, the 100 persons who are saying no to both 100 and tea, no coffee, no tea, then automatically this is 100, because this total is 200, this is 650, this is 150. Remember, if this sum is not equal to this or this sum is not equal to this, data is inconsistent. We are not collecting data properly. Therefore, how do you say data is consistent? Provided you are able to complete a 9 square table. Once you know one frequency, all frequencies are completed. Okay. Now here, the probability of selecting a person in us in that college who is taking T, is nothing but 800 by 1000. And the probability of taking a student who is not taking T, is 200 by 1000. We can calculate any probability. I am giving all probabilities for you. The probability of taking a person who is taking coffee, is nothing but 750 by 1000. And the probability of taking a person who is not taking coffee is nothing but 250 by 1000. And the probability of selecting a person who is taking tea and coffee,650 persons are taking tea and coffee, or among 750 persons who are taking tea, 650 are taking coffee, or among 800 persons who are taking tea, 650 are taking coffee. This way, that way. Among 750 persons who are taking coffee, 650 are taking tea. Among 600-800 persons who are taking tea, 650 are taking coffee. So probability of taking tea and coffee both is nothing but 650 by 1000. The probability of saying no to tea, and at the same time taking coffee, no to tea and taking coffee is 100 by 1000. And the probability of saying no to tea and no to coffee, both, they don't take coffee, they don't take tea, right? That is 100 by 1000.
100,000.
And the probability of taking tea but not coffee, taking tea but not coffee, 150 by 1,000. And the probability of taking yes, all probabilities, yes, 650, yes, 100, everything, all probabilities we have calculated. Anything, your probability of selecting a person who is taking a tea, stated in everything, all probabilities you can easily calculate, provided you prepare a table like this. You prepare a table like this. Now, instead of going for a circulating approach, this approach is very simple. In competitive examination, IIT, bank examination, they are asking this kind of question. They'll give one data like this. They'll give data like this. I'll tell you how to prepare this table. Your data will be given like this. Your data will be given like this. There are 10,000 persons in a village. There are 10,000 persons in a village. Therefore, you just complete this last, this square by 10,000. Out of 10,000 students, there are 10,000 students in a village. Out of 10,000 students, boys are 7,000. Boys are 7,000. Then automatically, girls are 3,000. So, out of 10,000 students, boys assess girls. Now, out of number of students passed, number of students passed is 6,000. Number of students failed, 4,000. So, I repeat again, there are 10,000 students in a village, 7,000 boys and 3,000 girls, and 4,000 not passed, that is failed, and 6,000 passed the examination, 4,000 failed in the examination. And this is nothing bad. Now, out of 7,000 boys, out of only girls passed, suppose you call this as 5,000. This is 1,000. This is 2,000. This is 2,000. See here, once you know one frequency, we are able to complete this. Once you know this, we can get this. Once you know this, you can get this, like that. Adding this plus this is this, this plus this, and so on. So therefore, the table is completed. They are giving this information, this information, this information, this information. That's all. So only this, out of 10,000 students in a village, 6,000 passed the examination, 7,000 boys are there. Among 7,000 boys, 5,000 passed the examination. Among 7,000 boys, 5,000 passed the examination, right? 1,000 girls passed the examination. 2,000 girls who have failed, and 2,000 boys who have failed. So therefore, ultimately, we can get a one. What is the probability of selecting a student? What is the probability of selecting who is a girl who has failed in this subject? That is, girl failed. That means 2,000. Probability of girl failing in the examination is nothing but 2,000 by 10,000. So, once you draw this table, the problem is immediate. The answer is immediate. So, therefore, we can easily get all the frequencies. It's very, very interesting, important also. Okay. I think with this, we are going to some problems. Okay, let us take one simple problem. A two-digit number, a two-digit number is formed using 3, 5, and 7. Using the digits 3, 5, and 7. Find the probability. Find the probability that number formed the probability that the number formed is greater than 57. Find the probability that the number formed is greater than 57. Now see, a two-digit number is formed using 357. Now our question is, how many two-digit numbers can be formed using 357? 35 is a two-digit number using digit 3 and 5. We can also reverse it, you get another two-digit number. This is different from this. This is 35, that is 53. Digits are 3 and 5, but order is considered. Therefore, 35 and 53. 37, 73. 57, 75. If you try to form some other number, it will be repetition. Condition is digits are not repeated. There is no repetition of digits. There is no repetition of digits. So we can form only six two-digit numbers, six two-digit numbers without repetition. 33, 55, 67, no, 77, not allowed. Among these six two-digit numbers that can be formed, therefore, number of equal likely cases is 6. How many are favorable to us? How many are greater than 57? How many are greater than 57? So, 73 and 75 are greater than 57. Therefore, 2 by 6, 1 by 3 is the answer. 1 by 3 is the answer. That means what? If you, that is, out of 6 numbers, 2 digit numbers that can be formed using 357. You take one number, see the number, put it again. You take the number, see the number, put it. Therefore, two times out of six times, you can expect the number greater than 57. Or if you take three times, once you can expect the number greater than 57. So, therefore, the probability of finding the number formed is greater than 57 is 1 by 3. Now, suppose in the same problem, same problem, we modify the problem. We are modifying the same problem like this. Instead of two digit numbers, a three digit number is formed. A three digit number is formed by using 357. Find the probability the number formed is greater than say 500. What's the probability that number formed is greater than 500? That means we have to form all 3D numbers using 357 without repetition of digits. One number is 357. The other number is 375. I am permuting these two. Keeping one fixed, I am permuting other two. I am fixing 5, 7, 3, fixing 5, 3, 7, fixing 7, 3, 5, fixing 7, 5, 3. Therefore, there are 6 three-digit numbers that can be formed. That's all. You cannot form more than 6. You cannot form more than 6. So, therefore, out of 6 three-digit numbers that can be formed, how many are greater than 500? How many are greater than 500? So, how many are greater than 500? 573, 537, 735, 753. 4 are favorable to us. Therefore, the answer is 2 by 3. That means, if you take 6 numbers, 4 times we can expect a number greater than 500. Or if you take 3 numbers at random, out of 3, 2 times we can expect a number greater than 500. So, therefore, this is only expectation. This is only an expectation. So, therefore, we can form or exhaust all this and ultimately we can get the probability. Okay, next. This is very, very important problem. This is an IIT problem. It's an IIT problem. 3 dice are rolled. Three dice are thrown. find the probability, find a probability that, or find a probability of getting 1, arithmetic progression, 2, 3 problems in this, geometric progression, 3, harmonic progression. 3 dice are thrown, find the probability of getting arithmetic progression, geometric progression, harmonic progression. In fact, while throwing 3 dice, you get 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, like that. You proceed, you go up to 6, 6, 6, you go up to 6, 6, 6, you would have written 216 outcomes. You would have written 216. Please try this. It's a very, very good brain work. Right? Writing all 216 outcomes itself is a very good brain work. So therefore, 216 possible outcomes are there when 3 dice are rolled. When 3 dice are rolled, there are 216 possible outcomes. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, like that. So you go up to 6, 6, 6, you get all 216. But 2 dice are rolled, 37. 3 dice are rolled, 6, 6, that is 6 cubed. 6 cubed is 6 into 6, 216 outcomes. Now, out of 216 outcomes, how many are favoring us? That is arithmetic progression. How many are arithmetic progression? How many shows geometric progression? How many outcomes shows harmonic progression? It's a very interesting problem. First of all, let us take arithmetic progression. First of all, let us take arithmetic progression. A is the event of getting arithmetic progression when 3 dice are rolled. What is arithmetic progression? 1, 2, 3 is an arithmetic progression. 1, 2, 3 is an arithmetic progression. 3, 2, 1 reciprocal, that is reverse order, it's also an arithmetic progression. Common difference 1, common difference is minus 1. 1, 3, 5 is an arithmetic progression. 5, 3, 1 is an arithmetic progression. It is the reverse order. Common difference is 2, common difference is minus 2. 2, 3, 4 is an arithmetic progression. 4, 3, 2 is an arithmetic progression. Then, 2, 4, 6 is an arithmetic progression. 6, 4, 2 is an arithmetic progression. Then, 4, 5, 3, 4, 5 is an arithmetic progression. 5, 4, 3 is an arithmetic progression. Then, 2, 4, 6, 2, 3, 4, 3, 5, 7, not possible. 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1, 1, 3, 5, 5, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 4, 6 is there. Yes, 3, 4, 5, and 2, 4, 6 is there. I have written 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. You get 12 possible outcomes. One more is nothing but 3, 4, 5. Yes, I have written 4, 5, 6 is an arithmetic progression. And 6, 5, 4 is an arithmetic progression. 4, 5, 6. 6, 5. Therefore, 2, 4, 8, 10, 12, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 12. There are 12 possible outcomes. There are 12 possible outcomes showing arithmetic progression. I repeat again, 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. 1, 3, 5, 5, 3, 1. 2, 3, 4, 4, 3, 2. 2, 4, 6, 6, 4, 2. 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3. 4, 5, 6, 6, 5, 4. It's also arithmetic progression. 4, 5, 6, common difference is 1, common difference is minus 1. There are 12 possible outcomes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 12 possible outcomes. Therefore, the probability of getting an arithmetic progression when 3 dice are rolled is nothing but 12 by 216. 12 by 216. This is the probability of getting an arithmetic progression when 3 dice are rolled. Therefore, this is probability of getting arithmetic progression is nothing but 12 by 216.
Now comes
geometric progression. I need not explain geometric progression because you get a common ratio. In geometric progression, you get a common ratio. Now, B is the event of getting a geometric progression. Multiply 1 by 2, you get this. Multiply this by 2, you get this. 1 to 4, it is in geometric progression. 4 to 1 is in geometric progression. That's all, only 2. There are only two outcomes showing geometric progression. Here common ratio is 2, here common ratio is half. Common ratio is half. Now, out of 216 cases, we see only two numbers, two outcomes showing geometric progression. Therefore, the probability of showing a geometric progression is nothing but 2 by 216. 2 by 216. This is the probability of getting a geometric progression. Probability of getting geometric progression. Now, we have seen arithmetic progression, we have seen geometric progression. Now you must see harmonic progression. You will see harmonic progression. First of all, you must know what is a harmonic progression. Harmonic progression, whenever three numbers are in harmonic progression, whenever three numbers are in harmonic progression, automatically the reciprocals are in arithmetic progression. The reciprocals are in arithmetic progression. Or the three numbers in arithmetic progression, the reciprocals are in harmonic progression. Therefore, with the great difficulty, we can say C is the event of getting harmonic progression. 3, 4, 6, 1 harmonic progression. 6, 4, 3 is an harmonic progression. Let us see how. Now see here. 3, 4, 6, they are in harmonic progression because they are in harmonic progression because let us see how they form harmonic progression. Now see here. 3, 4, 6, you take. I am saying they are in harmonic progression because 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 1 by 6 are in arithmetic progression. How? What's the difference between 1 by 4 and 1 by 3? 1 by 4 minus 1 by 3. Take 12 LCM. 3 minus 4 minus 1 by 5. Whereas if you take 1 by 6 minus 1 by 4, if you take 12 as LCM, 2 minus 3 minus 1 by 12. That means this difference is minus 1 by 12. This difference is also minus 1 by 12. Minus 1 by 12. If similarly, if you take 6, 4, 3, take reciprocal, the difference will be plus 1 by 12. We can easily verify the difference will be plus 1 by 12. So therefore, 3, 4, 6 are in harmonic progression. 6, 4, 3 are in harmonic progression. If you take reciprocal 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 1 by 6, 1 by 6, 1 by 4, 1 by 3 separately, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, 1 by 6, the common difference will be minus 1 by 12. Or 1 by 6, 1 by 4, 1 by 3, the common difference is plus 1 by 12. So, these only two outcomes showing as harmonic progression. If you try, you cannot succeed except these two. All others are giving, there is this, three numbers not in harmonic progression. Therefore, the probability of getting a harmonic progression when three dice are rolled is again 2 by 216. So, here is a chance to know about harmonic progression. So, three numbers are in harmonic progression if the reciprocals are in arithmetic progression. So, therefore, 3, 4, 6 and 6, 4, 3 are the only two outcomes showing us harmonic progression. Therefore, the probability of harmonic progression. Okay, so therefore, this is a very interesting, important problem connecting progressions and probability. And there is one more problem in this. The problem number 5 or 6. A and B throw 3 dice. A and B throw 3 dice. If A throws 16, if A throws 16, find B's chance. Find B's chance of throwing a higher number. B's chance of throwing a higher number. Here A throws 16 means total is 16. A is throwing 3 dice. B is throwing 3 dice. You get outcomes, 216 outcomes here, 216 outcomes there. If A throws 16, don't worry about that. We want B's chance of throwing a higher number. What is the probability of B throwing a number that is total, which is higher than 16? Higher than 16 means, suppose 666 we can throw. We can so throw the 666, total is 18. This is higher than 16. We can also throw 665, 17, total is 17. This 665 in this form, 656. That is 5 here, 5 here, and 5 here. That is, here total is 17. If you take any other possibility other than this 4, we are getting less than 17. We want B's chance of throwing higher number, that is higher than 16. 17 is higher than 16. 18 is higher than 16. Therefore, we can say the probability of B's chance greater than 16, higher number, is nothing but the probability of getting this or this, or simply greater than 17 means 1, 2, 3, 4 outcomes are favorable to us out of 216, already fixed. Because when 3 dice or when B throws 3 dice, there are 216 possible outcomes out of which 4 are favoring us. After which 4 are favoring us. Therefore, probability B is throwing greater than 16, a number higher than 16, is 4 by 216. It's a very interesting problem. They have asked this in Pitts-Pilani. So, this kind of problems will be asked. Direct problems will not be asked. Only some problems, right? Some brain work must be there. And when A is throwing 16, what is B's chance of throwing higher number means higher than 16? There are only two possibilities, 17 and 18. For 17, there are three possibilities, 18, only one possibility. So, therefore, ultimately, 3 plus 1, 4. 4 by 216 is the answer. So, this is a very interesting problem. Then, next problem is also equally important. What is the probability of selecting a leap year? What is the probability of selecting a leap year at random? At random contains Sundays. It's a standard problem. And similarly, the probability of selecting a non-leap year, containing 53 Sundays. Non-leap year containing 53 Sundays. We want both. Let us have a discussion, very, very, very important discussion. So many concepts are involved. What is the property of selecting a leap year at random containing 53 Sundays? If you understand carefully, can you understand? It's very easy. Only thing is, you must know some concept of divisional column, this, that, and so on. At the same time, we want the probability of selecting a non-leap year containing 53 Sundays. So, first of all, let us take a leap year, then you take non-leap year containing 53 Sundays. Leap year, all of you know, a leap year consists of 366 days. A non-leap year consists of 365 days. This leap year consists of 365 days. Let us calculate the number of weeks out of 366 days. You divide by 7. 7, 5, 35. 7, 2, 14. Remainder is 2. Remainder is 2. That means among 366 days, there are 52 weeks. 52 weeks plus 2 days remaining. Plus 2 days remaining. That means by division algorithm, by division algorithm, 366 can be written as 7 times 52 plus 2. This is divisional algorithm. This 366 is 7 times 52 plus 2. Multiply these two and add this remainder, you get this. That is divisional algorithm. So 366 is 7 times 52 plus 2. Now, we will discuss divisional algorithm separately after finishing this problem. Now, 52 weeks, definitely we get 52 Sundays. Definitely 52 Sundays you get, because there are 52 weeks. In a non-leap year contains 52 weeks, definitely. Every week one Sunday is there, therefore 52 Sundays you get. No doubt about it, there are 52 Sundays. Remember, we are selecting a non-leap year, a leap year at random. Leap year at random. Therefore, the remaining two days can be consecutive days. Sunday, Monday. It can be Sunday, Monday. It can be Monday, Tuesday. It can be Tuesday, Wednesday. It can be Wednesday, Thursday. Consecutive days. That's why I am writing like this. Thursday, Friday. Friday, Saturday. Saturday, Sunday. Sunday, Monday again it repeats. Therefore, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The remaining 2 days can be 2 consecutive days. Sunday, Monday. Monday, Tuesday. Tuesday, Wednesday. Wednesday, Thursday. Thursday, Friday. Friday, Saturday. Saturday, Sunday. It can be any one of these. Therefore, the probability of selecting 53 Sundays, when do you get 53 Sundays? Apart from 52 Sundays, if you have this combination, Sunday, Monday or Saturday, Sunday, only in two combinations, we are having one Sunday. 52 plus one Sunday, 53 Sundays. 52 plus this combination, one Sunday. Therefore, 53 Sundays. So, therefore, out of 7 combinations, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, out of 7 combinations, in 2, we are having 53 Sundays. Only 2 combinations, if you take first and last, Sunday, Monday, Saturday, Sunday, only 2 combinations, we are having 53 Sundays. So, therefore, probability of seeing 53 Sundays when a leap year is set at random is 7, 2 by 7. That means, if you take 7 leap years at random, among 7 leap years, in 2 leap years, we can expect 53 Sundays. So, therefore, out of 7 leap years, in 2 leap years, we can expect 53 Sundays. So this is a very, you can start Sunday, we can also have a Saturday. Instead of Saturday, we can also have a Friday. Instead of Friday, we can have Monday. Any day they can give. So the procedure is the same. The procedure is the same. So therefore, it's a very interesting problem. But for the second subdivision, for a non-leap year, non-leap year consists of 365 days. Non-leap year consists of 365 days. How do you get number of weeks divided by 7? 7 to 14. Again apply division algorithm. According to division algorithm, 365 is 7 times 52 plus 1. 7 times 52 plus 1 is 365. Now, since there are 52 weeks, 52 7 days, therefore 52 Sundays are there. 52 Sundays are there. The remaining one day can be Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. The remaining one day can be any one of these 7 days. Either Sunday or Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday or Friday or Sunday. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are 7 possibilities. In that possibility, if you take only this possibility, Sunday, you get 53 Sundays. That one happens to be a Sunday, we get 50 Sundays. If the one happens to be Monday, we don't get, we get only 52 Sundays. So therefore, the probability of getting 53 Sundays in a non-leap year is 1 by 7. That means, if you take 7 non-leap years at random, if you take 7 non-leap years at random, out of 7, 1 leap, non-leap year will have 53 Sundays. 1 non-leap year will have 53 Sundays. Here also, instead of Sunday, we can make it as Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or Friday, anything you can fix. Let me have, let me touch division algorithm. What is division algorithm? Let us take division algorithm for positive integers. A and B are 2 positive integers. Because you must know the concept of division algorithm. A and B are 2 positive integers. Such a subject to the condition A is greater than B. A is greater than. When one number is greater than another number, we can divide a bigger number by a smaller number. Since A is greater than B, we can divide by B. Q is the quotient, R is the remainder. Q is the quotient, R is the remainder. Q stands for quotient, R is the remainder. Then this A can be written as B times Q plus R. A can be written as BQ plus R, where R, it can be 0, R can be 0. If R is not 0, it must be greater than 0. At the same time, strictly less than B, this number. We are dividing by B. R, these R should satisfy this condition. This is very important in division algorithm. Whenever A is greater than B, then A and B are 2 positive integers. Divide A by B, Q is the quotient, R is the remainder. This A can be written as BQ plus R, where R, it can be 0, remainder can be 0. The remainder is not 0, it must be greater than 0. At the same time, it must be strictly less than B. We cannot say R is less than or equal to B. We cannot say like that. So therefore, R is strictly less than P. An example, suppose you are having 12, we are dividing 12 by 3. 3, 4, 12 remainder 0. Therefore, 12 is written as 3 times 4 plus 0. 12 is written as 3 times 4 plus 0. Another example, if you take 13, if you divide 13 by 3, 3, 4, 12 remainder. Therefore, 13 can be written as 3 times 4 plus 1. This remainder, see that it is less than 3. So, it, in this case, it is 0. In this case, 0. If it is remainder is not 0, it must be less than this number, less than 3. We are dividing by 3, it must be. It cannot be equal to 3. It should be less than 3. It cannot be negative also. So, therefore, R lies between 0 and P. R cannot be negative quantity. R cannot be negative. That is very important. R cannot be negative. R cannot be negative. This is division algorithm. We can also make use of division algorithm with polynomials. We can also write a polynomial, take two polynomials. For two polynomials, we can use division algorithm. For two polynomials, we can make use of division algorithm. Now, therefore, whenever two numbers are there, A is greater than B, if you divide by B, Q is the quotient, R is the remainder. R can never be negative, it should be 0 or greater than 0, at the same time less than B. Less than B. So, therefore, if once you know the concept of division algorithm, we can apply in so many places. It's a very important concept. Unfortunately and unfortunately, it is not included in the syllabus, right? So, without knowing that, we cannot proceed further. Therefore, everyone should have the concept of division algorithm. We can also use fx is a polynomial, gx is a polynomial. We are dividing, degree of fx is greater than degree of gx. We are dividing, qx is a quotient polynomial and rx is a remainder polynomial. Then, by division algorithm, fx is gx into qx, gx into qx plus rx, where rx can be 0, otherwise degree of rx is strictly less than degree of gx. That is precisely division algorithm for polynomials, division algorithm for polynomials. So, rx can be 0, remainder can be 0, then otherwise if it is not 0, the degree of rx be less than, should be less than degree of gx. This is precisely division algorithm for polynomials. Division algorithm for polynomials. So therefore, we can easily say, suppose x square, 2x square plus 1. Here we are dividing by x plus 1. Here 2x, we get 2x square plus 2x. We get 1 minus 2x. Therefore, we can write 2x square plus 1 as 2x into x plus 1 plus 1 minus 2x. This is a remainder polynomial. We can easily verify this on simplification. Exactly gives us 2x plus 1. At the same time, this is our quotient into this x plus 1. This is remainder. This degree of 1 minus 2x should be, in this case, we can all go one more time, we can divide, sorry, we can divide one more time, 2x square plus 1, x plus 1, 2x, 2x square plus 2x, 1 minus 2x, we get minus 2, minus 2x, minus 2, subtract 1 plus 2, 3. So, degree of this, we can simply write 2x square plus 1 as x plus 1 times 2x minus 2 plus 3. So, automatically degree of 3 is less than the degree of x plus 1, less than degree of x plus 1. So, therefore, this is degree division algorithm for polynomials. We can have like this so many concepts. In the probability, next class we are seeing so many problems, and after that we go to addition theorem and so on. Thank you.